here's one who says they currently shop on Amazon due to the diversity in the range. So the question to you is, how do you intend to sort of increase the range and options that are available to you, or are they missing the point? Do you compete head on in that regard?
Yeah, look, I mean, everyone's buying from everyone. I don't have a problem with that. Amazon is you know, very good at what they do. It's a very data-driven business, so they don't necessarily know how to promote and curate for the Australian consumer in terms of take a debut author that my team have read the book as a an advanced copy from the publisher, and they know it's going to be an award-winning book, and they can really get behind it and champion it to the Australian consumer. It's that kind of relationship that we have with our customers, that they understand that we're very passionate about books, and that's the one thing that we're focused on. So there will be times when Amazon is cheaper. It's not necessarily about being the cheapest. The range is, we've got 145,000. I actually want to get that up to 200,000 titles in stock. There are 30 million books active in the world. 6 million we keep on our website. We reject 24 million because they're not good enough for us. And of the 6 million that we keep on our site, only 150,000 at the moment are in stock. But it's not about the long tail. That's when you get into the onesies and the twosies where you need one or two of them. It's more in the head, right? I want to know that of those top 10, 20, 30,000 titles, we have got them in stock, and we have got plenty of stock because that's where the demand is. So the other thing is that Amazon doesn't do, and where our customer base is really strong, we've got schools, libraries, universities, government departments, they're all buying from us as well. So we have a team of people, many people in those teams who are managing those accounts and taking care of them in a way that an Amazon would never do. They're not going to go and bid for a tender to be on a tender of a government, government tender and be a preferred supplier. That's not their strategy. So there's quite a few things that we do that that they won't do, which therefore gives us quite a robust base.
There's also a number of questions about how you get feedback, and you've touched on that, and there's actually acknowledgement that there is a great range of books available. But one of the questions relates to logistics and user interface. And do you get comments back from users in that regard to help you continue to develop and improve the processes?
Oh, yeah. So there's quite a few things in that area, of course. So, we have a customer service team, as I mentioned. There's about 25 people here are doing second and third level support, and they're supported by a team in the Philippines who are doing first level support, which is basically, where's my book? And here's the tracking code, because you didn't look it up, and it's already on its way, for example, all the easy ones, which there are plenty of. So definitely, that customer care. Sorry, just Ian, what was?
It just talked about logistics and interface.
So there's that part, the customer care, the logistics and the investment in our logistics. So we just did a further 12 million on top of the 10 that we'd already done. We're just rolling out the first phase of our robots in our distribution center, which will help to increase the capacity of storage and put away and picking. It's a trial. We're taking one quarter of the warehouse to really test to make sure that this is really going to be the next thing for us. So that's pretty exciting. So the thing about supply chain and logistics, unfortunately, with the book industry, it's a 570-year-old industry. It's quite archaic, and it's a bit embarrassing how disconnected it is. Last week we had a book, for example, that was a textbook which needed to be printed on demand. It was just one of those books that wasn't required, for a whole course. It was, I think, some postgraduate work, and so we ordered it from the publisher. The publisher then has its printer in Singapore. They printed the one copy, shipped it to the distribution business in Queensland. Then it was shipped down to Booktopia, and then we shipped it to the customer. It's just really no one's really looked at it holistically, which is what we're doing right now in terms of retail distribution, and then also printing. Where are our printers? Can we bring them closer to us and have cut out a lot of this? There's a lot of freight companies making a lot of money out of the book industry, and have done for many years. And I'm really trying to address that.
Just a quick one, and it looks like we're coming up to around about time where we might extend, because we've got a number of good questions still coming in. So just a little bit of an alert to our audience is that we'll probably run a little over time, which means we'll probably go up to another 15 minutes, but not beyond that. So if you wanted to catch the next session scheduled to start around about the time we're scheduled to finish, please click back to the timeline and select that selection. But select that session. But those of you who want to stay with us, there's a good number of questions coming through, so I'll ask Tony these as we can. In a financial sense, do you anticipate paying a dividend? Is a question from Lee.
Yes. Unfortunately, I'm going for the trifecta, actually, is the one thing I want. I still want to have high double-digit growth in revenue. We've done that from FY 08 through to FY 20. It was 35% compound annual growth rate on our revenue, which is quite astonishing. I think it was about 25% from FY 18 through to FY 20. So I want to continue to grow the revenue. I want desperately for us to continue to look at our operational leverage and get to double digit if we can. I know it's tricky in the book industry and of EBITDA. That's my aspiration. If we can get there, and I want dividends. Those three things. It's pretty uncommon for e-commerce to have that kind of trifecta. Some of them do. A lot of them, including Amazon, are certainly in the beginning neglected that. But I think that builds a really sustainable business. I want to know that we're achieving all those things. Therefore, it really puts us in a very strong position for every year ahead as we do that.
A little bit of a technical question around e-readers. Leslie's saying that she's a long-term Booktopia customer, uses the e-reader Rakuten Kobo. Did I say that correctly?
Rakuten Kobo, yeah.
I think I was close. She's asking if there's other options that you may consider in the future that may be available. She's finding it a little bit, her word is her least favourite.
Yes. So, I mean, you can just download the app and use it on your phone or any other device if you wish. You don't need to be restricted to the Kobo. The Kobo reader, like the Kindle reader with the screen that is kind of like a, it's that nice, beautiful, like a page, but it's not an iPad, which is really glossy and bright lights. Is favored by many, but you can do that. I have just only in the last week had a one-on-one session with the CEO of Kobo in Canada, who's our partner, and they're excited about some of the new releases of devices that are coming through, in particular for those in the academic world. He was talking about that it's a bit bigger screen where you could do a bit more study. So I see that improving. It's one of those things where you just have to decide what's the best kind of way of consuming that content. I as I said, I'm an audio listener, so I'm not a big ebook. Even though I have my e-readers, I'm not using them to read books. I like, if I have to go and read a book, I grab a physical one.
Stuff. Questions, a couple of questions around this too, in terms of margins improving or the trend for margins going forward as you build scale. What's your expectation there? What do you see in the future?
Look, margins have been very consistent over in the book industry for decades. So the recommended retail price is the recommended retail price. You discount off that. The what you buy it for from the publishers is when you get to the levels that we are, everyone is pretty much getting the same kind of discounts. So you're not going to get any further discount to then create margins that way. What we have done is we've gotten to distribution, which I mentioned earlier in the presentation. So that means that we get quite a few extra points as the distributor, which means that in the total business, even though the retailer part of our business is buying from the distributor part of the business, which of course all the other bookstores like Amazon and Dimmicks and QBD and so forth, they're all buying from that business. But in the total company, which is of course what we report to the ASX, is where that extra profit sits. And it's that level of vertical integration into the industry that is giving us that buffer. And that's why as that business grows rapidly, I feel pretty comfortable around that, given that we not only we're getting that margin, but we're actually holding the stock on behalf of the ANZ territory, which puts us in a very strong position.
In a similar way, in a positive statement from one of attendees, talking about your exciting journey, their assumption was you had some sort of revenue trajectory, and I know you do. Since the nature of the markets have changed, how does that trajectory look today compared to, say, what you thought it might a decade or so ago, given the ebook and DVD, and I guess the post-COVID thing as well?
Yeah, oh boy, there's a lot in that, isn't there? The interesting thing for me is that the book industry has definitely been very consistent over all those years that I've been involved. Keeping in mind, I didn't start Booktopia thinking I'd be here talking with you today. It was like a little side project on a budget of $10 that just kept getting bigger and bigger. As I said, by asking that one question, what do our customers want, and focusing on that. The growth they asked one thing about that. I just wanted to get back to that. What are they specifically?
Ebook and say your revenue books. Trajectories. The competition's changed over the past decade or so, or the nature of the content.
Yeah, look, the main thing I think for people to come to terms with is that ebooks definitely. They had all the promise. They had all the, it ticked all the boxes in terms of, yeah, that makes sense. It's easy to download. You can have them all on your one book. But it's interesting that the proof in the pudding was that people actually reverted back to physical books. And it's important for people to understand it's not all about just the fiction title or the biography from an Australian author, for example. There's so many different technical books that are out there. There's coffee table books, there's box sets, the kids books, the board books, the bath books. Actually it's the reference manuals. There's so many books that are there that become part of the what we sell. And oddly enough, that's one of the things that I was astonished with in the beginning was how publishers were so obsessed with the new big book by this new author or a new book coming out from a famous author. Whereas the backlist, the books that were written 20, 30 years ago are the ones paying the rent and for your administration staff and were the backbone of your business. And so they're all a bit boring because they're not new, but I love the boring. And it's one of the reasons why I got into academia and tertiary textbooks because taught law, pathophysiology, if you want to go to sleep at night and sure, pull that out and start reading it, but they were selling and they were selling with huge numbers. And I think it's important for people to understand that that's actually quite, it goes quite deep and quite wide in terms of all those genres and areas. So E is definitely going to be around. It won't be as big, it'll be there and for the right circumstances. But I hear a lot of stories, that their e-reader is in the cupboard next to their bread making machine. So it's like, we gave it a go and it wasn't for me.
I can sort of identify that with that, but I don't have a bread maker. I think this deals with your logistics and freight timelines and moving stuff around. What percentage of books that were purchased but unlikely to be sold? What is the percentage of books purchased that you may not sell? Or do you run a tight just-in-time inventory management?
So books that were purchased
I think the assumption is that you actually buy books, put them on in a warehouse, then you sell. So I'm guessing that may not be the case. You actually purchase to expect
right.
to manage demand.
Yeah, so of the, correct. So of the 140,000 that we have in stock, 80% of what we ship comes from that and 20% we need to order in. It's a book, it's the other 5.8 million odd that we don't stock. And that means that people know we can get it and it might take a little time. It's not a popular title. So therefore they're patient and they'll wait for it. But we want to stock what we know people are buying. We've actually analyzed the data and we've worked out that if we take a book that was not a stock title and add it to stock, we'll sell four times as many. When it says on the website ship straight away, and when we are out of stock of that, and it's normally a stock title, sales halve. And so our goal and our investment right now is to make sure that we have everything that people want, in particular because we ship 7.5 million books this year, of 3 million parcels. The last thing we want to do is have four books that someone ordered, of three which are in stock and the other one that should have been in stock but wasn't. We're shipping those first three straight away because that's what the customers want and that's what we do. And then the fourth one goes when it comes in, could only be a day later or 2 days later or a week later, but then the next one goes. That means we've made two shipments, and Australia Post, of course, another freight company, is the beneficiary because we didn't have a stronger stock position. Now, historically, we had to do that because we were growing off our own, it was organic. We had no funding. We had to make sure that we made every dollar work for us. So, but now that we're at the position where we're at, I want to address that because all of that can drop to the bottom line. Those reducing those multiple shipments per order is super important to extracting more value out of what we've got.
In terms of other business opportunities, the question is, do you see any broader adjacencies or not that might suit Booktopia's business model? In other words, are you sticking with your knitting or are you going to do other stuff that you can leverage?
I love that question because I was going to put that actually into the first part of the presentation, but I was desperate to get to the questions. Interestingly, so about 5 or 6 years ago, we had bought Angus and Robertson and we also bought a camera business, online camera business. We wanted to prove to the market that we could make acquisitions within industry and also make acquisitions outside of industry and make them flourish, right? But I started to do my research and I was wondering, what was it in North America and Europe where Amazon was in a mature state that some companies were flourishing? And everywhere I looked, it's because they focused on one thing and did it really, really well. And we had started the camera business and I could see that we had to put a lot of effort in to get it going, much more so than to get that from 2 million to 5 million than we would need to have gone from in Booktopia to go from 100 million to 110 million, you know, per se. So it was interesting. The guy that took over catch.com.au recently when Wesfarmers bought them is an American guy who was very high up in Seattle. And he and I had this one-on-one catch up a number of months ago. And I gave him this idea because he was right over there, right amongst the leadership of Amazon. And I asked him and I told him my theory around this focusing on one thing. He said, Tony, that is absolutely correct. The ones that are doing really well is because they focused on one thing. And it was then that I decided to get into distribution and publishing because that was deeper into our vertical. And I knew that that was the right thing to do. So for me, it's more about books is quite a big industry, and I want to know how we can get to 500 million in Australia. You know, how long is that going to take? What have we got to do? I've got no time frame on that. There's nothing. It's just, you know, a long-term, medium to long-term aspiration. But then how do we get to New Zealand? How do we get to Asia? How do we get into North America and Europe as well, using this very focused model?
You're playing to some of the questions that are coming up. I think you've touched on this as well. What industry do you classify your company being in? Is it tech, retailing, or e-commerce, or marketplace?
Yes, to all of them. No, if you had to nominate, I would say that we're a tech and logistics company, and a lot of the tech goes into the logistics as well. So that supply chain issues. Because when you scale, when you literally you're going from 100 million to 200 to 300. It may sound easy for you and I who aren't there in the distribution center trying to get the books out the door, but you hit these capacity choke points where you've got to continue to invest in that automation. Amazon obviously are experts at this globally, but for us, it's making sure that we can be able to get that product in and out without having to throw more people at it, and therefore, because that's not scalable. And so for us, it's matching that investment in the automation to the future kind of forecasting of what we know our customers are going to ask of us and how many books we're going to have to get out the door.
And possibly one of our attendees joining us from New Zealand. In the NZ market, how do you compare with Mighty Ape?
I actually don't know. I know that Kogan just bought Mighty Ape. They do sell books. Our New Zealand business is quite small. It's only, I think, 1 or 2 million. It's not very big. We mostly use Trade Me to sell books into New Zealand. But when we go to New Zealand, we're going to have to do it properly. We own booktopia.co.nz and have done for many years. We need to set up a distribution center. We need to have a website that's, you know, black, white, and gray with a silver fern up the top. And on the front page, you have to have the autobiography of the All Blacks captain. I mean, goes without saying. So we know that you can't be an Aussie company doing it from here to there and get away with it. You really do need to address, you know, what New Zealand readers want. And when we're ready to do that, we will have to do it properly and get over there and set it up properly. So I don't know how big Mighty Ape is actually. I know they have books on their website, but it's not.
Right.
They're not as big as some. I think toys and games and electronics is there. That's why Kogan bought them. I think they've got more of an overlap to Kogan.
Right. And you always add Sir Edmund Hillary's biography to the web pages also.
Oh, yeah, of course.
I'm going to ask one last question and wrap up because we're conscious of getting close to time and our extended time. There's still a couple of comments and questions coming in, but we'll send those through to you and you can follow up on those and address those as you think appropriate. But an interesting one, didn't quite see this one coming. Given your backdrop, which you've assured me are real books, and you've showed the bookcase, there we go. So it's the Rigi Dig, it's not an artificial backdrop. Question is, what is Tony's favourite book? What's your favourite book?
I get asked that a lot by journalists, funnily enough. So To Kill a Mockingbird is definitely probably my favourite book in terms of what I would, you know, want to read over and over again. In fact, I was in New York for the Book Expo a few years ago and they had a play with Jeff Daniels on Broadway. It was just such a delight to go and see that. In terms of business books, though, I tell you, Brené Brown, there's many business books, but Brené Brown of recent, she's on Oprah every now and then. Gosh, she really calls you to account as a leader. If anyone hasn't read her or is interested in that kind of leadership and business and making sure that you're accountable and challenging yourself, I do love listening to her audiobooks. It's really inspiring. But boy, there's so many of recent in terms of Australian authors. Trent Dalton's Boy Swallows Universe was absolutely a delight, and personally, if I'm really going on a wave, anything people may not agree with Peter Fitzsimons, Fitzy, but GZ writes some very good Australian historical nonfiction, and the detail that his research team and he go into to tell us about Australian history and the people and our past. I just anything from Roland Perry and Fitzy and those kind of authors, I'll devour.
All right, you've given us plenty of choice there. I did read To Kill a Mockingbird some years ago and followed on with Catcher in the Rye, a few things that I read when I was at school again. But Tony, we're right on time. And as you indicated, a short, sharp presentation with all the slides available for those who want to go further into your slide deck. But more was the case, as you said, it would be that a lot of questions that came in for you and which you've answered them admirably. As I say, there's a couple left over which we'll get around to you as well. So thank you for joining us today and presenting at the ASX Small and Mid-Cap Conference.
Thanks for your interest. Really appreciate it.